Coffee drinkers, sight reading at a slow tempo, but at the end of the day, it's actually that complex.
Terrible!
Coffee drinkers, we are talking about sight reading. I'm psyched to tell you about the fact that Bass Player's Guide for Sight Reading is now out. It's been a really long time coming, really one of the toughest books I've ever had to write because it's so technically demanding on the theory front. It's not just me and a bunch of licks and how I like to play them and purpose them with music and development of motifs and ideas. No, it's something that's been around for hundreds of years. It has helped millions of musicians navigate the musical world. And now it's in a book. And what you just heard right up front in this video is one of the pieces of music towards the end of the book, it has to be said, because that's a little more on the complex side with ledger lines and higher tempo and a little bit more complicated in the position shifts and fingering and all that stuff. But it's sight reading. It's all about gaining access to music. And as I say in the book a little bit, it's like people, they want to learn how to sight read. I hear this sentiment all the time, like, oh man, I play bass, I play guitar, whatever instrument it is, and maybe this person even plays great, maybe they're a great musician, but they never really learn how to read music or how to sight read music. And I hear it so often, like, oh yeah, I tried for a while and then it just kind of, you know, petered out and I kind of forgot it all. So yes, right up front, it's a muscle like any other muscle. If you don't use it, you really do lose it. So it's something you really kind of have to practice, just like everything else, if you want to be able to, on demand, at the drop of a hat, get handed a piece of music and read it successfully. But I put this to you, it might not actually be sight reading that you're looking for. It might simply be reading music, getting away from tab, getting away from all these shortcuts and tricks and tips and hacks, and actually just having access to an immense amount of music just because you can understand standard notation. So the book starts there. It starts with just understanding the basics of notation and rhythm and where all the notes are, and then of course moves through a really nice arc to the end of the book where it's more complex and we're looking at ledger lines and key changes and tough keys to play in with lots of sharps and lots of flats, that kind of stuff. But in this video, let's get to the crux of why, yes, I do think it's important that as bass players, as musicians in general, we should be able to read. We don't have to be top level movie score musicians who can read anything on demand and do it under the clock and under pressure and all those other things. We just simply have to be able to understand standard notation to gain access to an amazing wealth of information that's out there that if you can't read music, can't read standard notation, you're probably not going to have access to, which is a shame because there are some beautiful things to understand and to hear and see in music. Like, I've got an arranging book right here. This is Bill Dobbins' Jazz Arranging and Composing, A Linear Approach. I had this book for years and it is a great example of like this. When was the last time you looked at something like that? That's a score. That's treble clef, that's bass clef. This is more of a jazz score, so there's no alto or tenor clef like a viola and cello kind of stuff in there. But there's a lot of information there. Not terribly complex, though, when you understand the basics of standard notation. And that's the point I'm trying to hit home with this video, with the book, which is linked below if you want to check it out. Physical copies at Amazon.com, shipping worldwide almost immediately. Digital copies at my website. It comes with 80, a lot, let's just say, of videos, 4 masterclass, 80 videos, and 46 play-alongs. The piece of music you heard at the top of this video is one of the play-alongs that comes with the book. Everything has a play-along. There are bass lines, understanding the 16th note grid, displacement, really improving your rhythm, just tons of stuff in there. It is chocked full of information. I sweat my brains out putting it together. So that's available. It's linked below this video. But check that out. Like, just knowing a little bit about rhythm, a little bit about standard notation, I can actually look at this page of music and already hear roughly how it's going to sound. I don't have perfect pitch. I couldn't sing the exact notes where they're supposed to be, but I can see the intervals of them. I can see the rhythms of them. And if nothing else, the rhythmic thing to me, when you're reading music and eventually sight reading music, super important, especially when it's not as like neat and clean and crisp like this, you know, like this Blues for Barry here. Look at that chart. That's like beautiful. It's just really easy to read. It's super clear. But here's the reality of the kind of things we get given on gigs. I'm sure if you... I hadn't even seen the back of this. I'm going to show you this, which is already a bit of a mess. There's Whiteout or Tippex if you're in the UK. It's handwritten. Like, look at this rhythm here. How bunched up that is, and illegible almost, and bits scrubbed out, and just terrible penmanship. But I tell you what, I was handed this on a gig, and I read the crap out of it, and the gig was really fun, and you know, everyone dealt. That's a little bit more experience in terms of just being able to read like total crap charts like this. But it was also about just seeing like, okay, we've got some notated bass lines here. It's not just chord symbols. We got notated bass lines. So before the song started, I scanned ahead. I looked, okay, boom, ba-da-da. I need to not be left, you know, looking around at the rest of the band when that moment comes. The chord symbols, I'm sure we can all read. But when we get that unison thing and it's all the horns and the drums and the percussion and the piano and the bass, hopefully, if you have your reading together, just looking ahead before we started that song, checked in with the rhythm. Of course, I had a 30 seconds maybe, so I checked the notes as well. It's only 4 bars of notated material. But it's those reactive skills that come from studying the stuff that's in the book in Bass Player's Guide to Sight Reading, but also just the overall lifelong study and practice, like having this stuff in your practice routine that really helps you through little gigs like this. And look at this, there's no clef on this piece of, let's say, music at the top here. Somebody's notated something there. I don't know if that's treble or bass clef, but if it is either one of those, I do have a little bit of understanding of the treble clef, which I talk about in the book as being kind of important, because sometimes people will notate melodies in treble clef for you because it's easier to notate than a ton of ledger lines. I'm just prepared. And this is just eighth notes, simple intervals, not too many sharps and flats, accidentals. So it's really just useful to have that super basic understanding of reading music. So you get on a gig, you get handed a horrible chart. Oh boy. Not as horrible as what's on the back. And I'm seeing this for the first time. This is really bad. Like, I don't know if this is my buddy Andy that wrote this, Andy Sinisi, or maybe somebody wrote it for him, but that is one of the worst I've ever seen. Like, the chord symbols, even if we're just reading a chord chart, the chord symbols and the rhythms right here are so small and almost illegible. Let's just say that's a pretty extreme example of what you might get. It's kind of an updated version of that chart, I guess. Somebody's taken the time to really kind of make it a little clearer. The bar numbers on each line still aren't that even. There are still things I wouldn't have done there, but that's definitely a little clearer. I want to show you some of my chicken scratch, some of my handwriting, and also a byproduct of working on your reading. When you like get into the first, you know, chapter of this book, for instance, we're talking really basic stuff. We're talking whole notes, half notes. We're talking simple rhythms. We're talking notes that are contained in the staff. We obviously step it up and cover the whole range of the bass. But as you go through the understanding, the development of the understanding of basic rhythms, it's not just for your reading. Of course, it's for your notation as well. I hear so many people ask the question like, hey, I'm transcribing some stuff. Do you really write that down? Well, first of all, the answer is yes, I do. I have dozens and dozens and dozens of books like this full of transcriptions. They ask about the importance of writing it down. I say, for me, it's because I'm getting old and my memory just can't possibly handle the sheer volume of information that I like to transcribe and notate. And then the next thing comes, but man, I really don't understand rhythm. Rhythmic notation. I hear that from really serious musicians sometimes. People who are very accomplished, people who play complex rhythms and don't even think about it. But making that connection between playing them and notating them, that's a gap we need to bridge. And that's something that is, I think, a byproduct of beginning to understand the rules and the theory behind reading and eventually sight reading music. So here's that byproduct in action right there. That's a solo I'm working on. You'll notice that I'm actually notating it in treble clef. This is, it's a guitar solo. So it makes sense to me to notate it in the register and the range that it would be written for that instrument. Also with the bass, it's gonna be a lot in the high register of the bass, so I don't particularly wanna write a ton of ledger lines. We can of course write within the staff and then put 8VA above it and for as long as we want it to be played up the octave, but perhaps notated an octave lower than it sounds. That's, you know, that's me kind of at lightning speed writing stuff down. It's not the clearest thing in the world, but it makes sense to me and I can read that. And that's essentially with the notation of transcription, what you need at the end of the day. Unless you're gonna digitize it and put it into a notation software and share it with people or use it as teaching information and supplemental material, that's good enough. I did find just now as I was preparing for a video, I used to actually write in pen. It's kind of a bit of a no-no because mistakes, you're gonna end up with whiteout all over the page like this person did here. But thankfully, this is Mike Stern's solo on Suspone on the rhythm changes of a Mike Brecker tune. And apparently, I didn't make any mistakes with this one. I'll probably go back and find that there are actually some wrong notes in it because I did this about 20 something years ago. But that's another example of being a little clearer with your notation. This is very eighth note heavy, as you can see. So the rhythm isn't particularly complicated or dense, but really important to make sure it's not just a single thing you're getting out of the practice of reading. Pay attention to the note values and to the rhythmic element of what it is you're reading, because that is going to pay off huge down the road when you want to notate something, whether it be a transcription, whether it be a chart for your band, whether it be a composition you're writing that you're handing to people in a recording studio. Priceless skill to have when it comes to music. And again, the point I really want to hammer home here is that it's really not just sight reading. I think sight reading is the next step, but for a lot of people, it is the understanding, the comprehension of standard notation, getting away from tab. Tab is utterly useless outside of Bass Guitar Magazine or, you know, janky transcription on the internet where someone was lazy and wanted a bigger audience of people who didn't really want to do it. Basically, what I'm trying to say is standard notation is like this much of notation in the world, and tab is as thin as a sheet of paper. Like that's how useful it is. So to highlight that, like this is a classic piano book, Hannon, the Virtuoso Pianist. I guess I've been associated with this book for a really long time because I adapted so many of the exercises in this to the bass and use them to build my fundamental technique on the instrument. But when we open the book, look at this. If you don't read standard notation, you don't have access to all this amazing stuff, like really amazing material, and great for practicing treble clef and bass clef because it's a piano book. Just that really highlights the importance of not sight reading, but actually just basic reading, doing it on your own time, not having to do it in real time, under pressure, all those things. Just this basic comprehension of standard notation, I think, is hugely important. That's where I recommend you start if you're questioning or thinking about, okay, I really want to learn how to read. That's where I'd start, simply reading. Don't put any pressure on yourself. Take it really slowly. Take it simple. Don't try and start out with the tune that you heard at the beginning of the video. There's a reason why that tune isn't example number one in the book. It's down there. It's in section 3 or 4 or something when you've really got some chops together. But there are so many cool reading exercises in the book to get your rhythmic displacement together, to understand the 16th note grid and being able to displace every 16th note and where they fall. And most importantly, what it looks like. You more than likely already know all of these rhythms, all of these note values, all of these notes, these intervals, all of this stuff. You just need a visual representation of that on the page. That is what I hope the book gives you. Regardless of whether you get the book or not, that is what reading music gives you. So no matter how you go about it, whether you get my book or not, or you have your own way to do it, those are some of the concepts I would encourage you to employ, simply because there is access to so much more information once you understand the basic standard notation of music. So if you made it this far, awesome. Thank you very much for hanging out. Always appreciate when you come by my channel. Hit the subscribe button, hit the bell. Give us a thumbs up if you dig what you're seeing. Also, recently new to me is Twitch. I'm live streaming pretty much every weekday at 10:30 a.m. over here in California. If you haven't already joined me on a stream, come and join the chat, come and join the conversation. My Twitch channel is linked below. Make sure you are following there. And as I said, normally Monday through Friday, 10:30 a.m. Brand new to me, whole new world. It's the wild, wild west of streaming on a regular basis as a musician, but it's been super cool. I've done live pedal board builds, octave pedal shootouts. We've had thousands of questions about all things music related and a bunch of things unmusically related as well, but it's a blast. I'm having fun doing it. I think it's maybe the way forward, maybe where a lot more of my content is going to be positioned moving forwards from here. But it only works if you guys come and hang out and grow the conversation and kind of make it all worthwhile as a community. So my Twitch channel is linked below. Make sure you're following. Wow. Okay. That was a lot. All right, and that's it. That's the end. That's all I got today. Bass Player's Guide to Sight Reading. It's available below. Comes with 80 videos, 46 play-alongs. It was a real labor of love. I hope you enjoy it if you check it out. And give me some feedback. Leave me some comments on the video. And hopefully I will see you here. And more importantly right now, on Twitch very soon. Thank you.